up a pen and a page, and I started writing just what I'd say if we were face to face. I tell you just what you mean to me, tell you these simple truths. Be strong in the Lord and never give up hope. You're gonna do great things, I already know. God's got his hand on you, so don't live life in fear. Forgive and forget, but don't forget why you're here. Take your time and pray. These are the words I would say. You were hurting, and I felt your pain in my heart. I want to tell you that I keep on praying. Love will find you where you are. I know, 'cause I've already been there. So please hear these simple truths. Be strong in the Lord and never give up hope. You're gonna do great things, I already know. God's got his hand on you, so don't live life in fear. Forgive and forget, but don't forget why you're here. Take your time and pray. These are the words I would say. From one simple life to another,
I was looking over what to say, and I know you've been given so much advice already from your lovely parents and folks around you. I want you to know that everything out there is there. I mean, you can be what you want to be. You can do what you want to do with God's help. And I would say that. I would say just ask Him. Just ask Him when you make a move, when you ask Him about a career change or a college or whatever you do, just ask Him, Lord, what do you want for me? What do you want me to do? Where do you want me to pursue for you? And you can be as successful and have a great, great life. And yes, there'll be some downs. There'll be some great ups. But God will never leave you. He'll never forsake you, even through the most difficult days of your life. And there's people all over this congregation that could share that with you, that God is always faithful. Even though when we don't understand sometimes, He is still faithful. And so what I wanted to share with you today is I want you never to be afraid to say no to the world, all right? And you're going to get an opportunity to say yes to a lot of things, all right? You're going to head off to college and different things, and, man, it's going to be wide open. For the first time ever, mom and dad's not going to be right there saying, don't do this and don't do that. And you get to do whatever you want, all right? You get to exercise your free will. But let me put a little warning symbol on that, all right? With every selection of our free will, there's consequences, both good and bad. Amen? There's always consequences. So I would just ask you to be quick to say no to the world. I wanted to give you a couple stories in the Bible real quick. And I want to tell you about someone that said no to the world that I've been reading about recently that just overwhelmed me. But our first story is in Mark. It's in Mark chapter 10. And this was a young man that thought he had it all figured out, all right? And a lot of times, I remember at 18, I think I can remember that far back. It gets a little foggier every year, Gary. I don't know. It's just getting a little foggier. But I knew one thing. I wasn't afraid of much, okay? Our fear factor is real low when we're young. As I get older, I'm afraid to even walk across the room sometime. But we weren't afraid of a lot. And we also thought, I've got this figured out. Just give me my space. You know, get back a little bit. I've got this, all right? And we thought we had a lot figured out. And maybe some of it we did, okay? Maybe some of it we did. Some we didn't. But this young man thought he had it all figured out. Listen to me as I read. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. Good teacher, he asked. See, right there's a mistake right there. Good teacher. He didn't even recognize it was Son of God. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus answered. No one is good except God alone. Jesus was trying to get him to recognize the one true God. You know the commandments, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony, and you shall not defraud, honor your father and mother. Teacher, he declared, listen to this answer, all these I've kept since I was a boy. I've got this figured out. I'm a pretty good guy. And there's going to be times in our life, guys, in your life, that you're going to, I'm a good person. Why is this happening to me? I thought I had this all figured out, and sometimes it's going to get difficult. Sometimes in our life, we think, we're pretty good people. Why is this happening to us? We wonder why God does some things that He does. But Jesus knows our heart, okay? You can tell, we can lie to a lot of people, and we can tell everybody everything's okay, but Jesus knows our heart, and He's seen right into the heart of that young man that day, and He asked him something. He gave him a command. He told him to do something. Jesus looked at him and loved him. He loved him. See the compassion Jesus had for him? He said, I can hear him processing in his brain. He just don't quite get it. Jesus looked at him and He loved him. He wanted him to know eternal life, and He loves you guys. He wants you to know eternal life. He wants you to know how much He cares for you. He said, one thing you lack. He said, go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. What was Jesus saying in all that? Go say no to the world and come follow me and I'll give you eternal life. Look how he answered. At this, the man's face fell. He went from excited and I've done all that. I've got this made. And God said, one thing you lack. You still haven't given me everything. And I don't think, guys, it was so much that he goes sells everything he's got. All right, there's nothing wrong with money, all right? It's not the love of it's not the money that's the root of all evil. It's the love of money that's the root. It's when you get so greedy and I want more and more and more that nothing else matters. So it wasn't so much the love of his money and all those things, but it was that he wasn't turning everything over to God. And listen, you're going off to college. You go, man, I know Christ. I've given my heart. But you know what? It's real easy, and I know this from experience, guys. It's real easy in those years of college to set God over here on the side and say, I'll be back. I'll be back in a year. I'll be back in a couple. I'll be back in 4 years, and we'll talk again. And that's happened to a lot of folks in this room. It's real easy to set him to the side. And this young man, he said, I just can't say no to the world. And what does it say? His face fell, and he went away sad because he had great wealth. He went away sad. And guys, listen to me. I want you to chase your dreams. I want you to go after whatever you feel God wants you to go after. But I'm telling you, if you put everything into chasing stuff and leave God sitting here, you'll get down at the end of that and you'll feel empty, okay? You'll feel sad. And that happens in the world today. You see great people that are, man, they're athletes, they're rock stars, they're country stars, they're movie stars, they've got it all. And still at the end of the day, what is it? They're sad. Because they can't say no to the world. And there's a time that all of us have to say no to the world. And he went away sad. It's a really, really sad story. And let me tell you about story number two. Here's a guy that was in control, all right? I'm in control. This is over in Luke 12. Jesus was talking in parables. Y'all remember us telling you about a parable? A parable is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning, all right? He's giving him an illustration. And he told them in this parable, the ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, what shall I do? I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, this is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store up my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night, your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves but is not rich toward God. I'm in control. I'm doing all right. And there's going to be times you feel like that, all right? I'm in control. I'm doing all right. I'm getting everything I want. I'm successful. Someday you may look around. I've got the house I always wanted. I've got the family I've always wanted. But guys, if we've left God out of the picture and we've done nothing for God, and I'm talking to all of us this morning, if we've left God out of the picture and we've chased all these dreams, and then it comes time when it's time to leave this world, y'all remember the only thing that's going to count when we get to heaven is what we've done for the Lord. He said, don't lay up for yourselves riches on this earth where rust and moth and things decay it and rot it. You know, everything we got wears out, amen? You guys have bought stuff. You've had iPhones and all those things, and they're great for a while when they're new, but then they get old and they start crashing, and you're ready to get another phone, all right? Sometimes they're working perfectly, and you just want a new phone because that's a new phone, right? Amen, mom and dad, amen, all right? You know, we know how it is, okay? But sometimes we look at this and we go, I'm in control, but then we realize at the end of life or whenever life comes, and guys, we don't know. I pray that every one of y'all live to be 100 years old. And great health, I really do. We just don't know. This is a crazy world. We've seen that this week, how fragile life is with these young men. You guys, I was so proud of the school, standing up and praying for them and just, you know, the teachers. Guys, here's the sad part of this, just kind of a sidebar. Here's the sad part of this. I was talking to the kids this morning, and that the teachers could not even go out and pray with them because it would be against the law, you know? But the kids stepped out. One of our star football players steps up and he says, I'll lead in prayer. And those kids gathered around the flagpole and prayed for those boys. And I thought that was huge. I thought that was huge that you guys would make that step for God. Thank you for doing that. Because you knew where the answers were. And guys, don't forget that, okay? Don't forget that. Sometimes we pray to God more when things are hard, but you pray for him every day because he knows how to answer your problems. Here, this man thought he had it all figured out. He said, man, I got big barns and I've got more crop than I know what to do with. I'll just build bigger barns. I'll just build bigger houses. I'll get more stuff. And in this little story that God was telling him, Jesus said, but that night, his life ended. And then, what was that stuff going to go? Jesus said, it'll just be left behind for people to fight over. There's nothing wrong with stuff, guys. Please don't misunderstand what I'm saying. There's nothing wrong with chasing your dreams. There's nothing wrong with doing great in life. I pray success for all of you. But don't put your stock in that it's greater than anything else in your life. There's only one thing that deserves your fullest attention and your fullest praise, and that's Jesus Christ. It's Jesus Christ. It's the best thing going. There's some other men in the Bible that could say no to the world. They were great examples. You've probably heard of these men through the times that you spent with us here at church. Moses, he was a governor, a pharaoh almost. He got adopted by the queen's daughter, and man, he was doing great. But God called him for a different purpose. And of course, he did some things in there in the middle with murdering somebody wasn't real good, all right? Let's just be honest. But when he left, God got his attention. He said, you can't go back and be bound to the world. I've got a job for you to do. And so Moses stepped aside. He said no to all that fame and fortune and being high up in the Egyptian, all the reign and the kings and all that. He said no to that. Another one was Daniel. Daniel was another one that had worked his way up. He was living in a foreign land for a people that defeated them and had defeated them in an army and in war. And he was moving up the ladder, and all of a sudden they didn't like him, some of the people, and they got this law, and he said, you can't pray three times a day. And Daniel said, no. He said, I'm going to pray. Just like you guys did the other day. You prayed. It's awesome. You said no to the world. And you said yes to God. And Daniel did that. He prayed. He kept praying. He spent a night in lion's den because of it. But God rescued him. God rescued him. His other friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, said no to the world. They said, all right, everybody, when this band plays, I want you to bow down to this big idol, to this king. And they said, no, we only serve the one true God. We will not bend. We will not bow. It cost them a trip to the fiery furnace. What I'm telling you is when you say no to the world, it's not going to be all peaches and cream, okay? It's not always going to be the best thing. Sometimes it's going to get really hard. And guys, I think you guys are facing some of the most difficult things in America that any of us has ever dreamed coming in the next 15 to 20 years. And there's going to be a time when you're going to say, nope, that Bible they gave me when I graduated, I read in there that that's wrong. That is wrong. And I'm going to stand on God's word because it's always right. And you're not going to be popular. They're going to blast you. But you stay strong on God. You stay strong with God. It will be worth it. Zacchaeus, there was a rich man, all right? He had it going on. Tax collector, getting a little bit of extra money in his pocket every time. But along come a man that changed his life. And of all things, he was up in a tree. He was up in a tree trying to just see what the world was going on. And Jesus said, come down, I'm going to your house today for lunch. And that meeting with Jesus changed his life. Within just mere hours, he said no to the world. He said, no, I'm not doing this anymore. And as a matter of fact, everybody I've done wrong, I'm giving their money back plus more. That's how crazy God can make you. That's how peculiar God can make you. See, the Bible uses the word peculiar. These guys were peculiar. The world's going to call you peculiar when you follow God. All of us are going to call us peculiar. But you know what? When you look at that and break it down in the Greek, you know what that means? Costly. It means costly. It means treasured. Guys, Lord thought you were worth something. We talked about that this morning, guys. This young man, it just broke my heart. 10th grade. Can you imagine a 10th grader that thinks that nobody loves him? That he thinks that this world's not worth living for anymore? That's so sad. I told our class this morning, we talked about it just for a moment. I said, guys, you have worth. You are treasured. You are a costly possession of Christ. How do I know that? Because he gave the only son he had and shed his blood on a cross. You are loved. You are treasured. That's why he asks us to be peculiar. So that others may know that they are loved, that they are treasured, and they are a costly and a valuable person. It breaks my heart that people would think that there's no sense of going on at 16 years old. Of course, Paul was a Jew of Jews. Paul had it all figured out, very smart man. But God got a hold of him and changed his life. And he said no to all his past. Now, he loved those people, and he always wanted to see them come to Christ, but he went out to the whole world and said, I want to bring you what God has done for me. And then, of course, we know Jesus. Jesus said no to sin. He said no to the world. He said no to the devil that night in the garden, said, I will not do this for people. I'm going to do this. You can't talk me out of it. Not my will, but your will be done, is the way the Bible put it. And he let them nail him to a cross. That's pretty peculiar, isn't it, Birch? That you'd do something like that. That's how much Jesus loves you guys. That's some good people. I wish there were people like that in this world today. You know what? I've been reading about a guy that is. Let me show you a picture of him. Maybe you've heard about him lately. This is Adam LaRoche and his son Drake. He played for the Chicago White Sox. You might have heard about him about a month ago. They were in spring training. And he used to always bring his son to the clubhouse, and he'd hang around the ballpark with his dad. And he told the coaches, he said, look, if this ever gets to be a problem, let me know. Well, this year they come up to him, it was a problem to one of the new players there, and they said, I don't think he belongs in the clubhouse. And you know what? My first thought, this is how first impressions will get you, all right? My first thought was, yeah, he don't really need to be there. There's too much going on. I wouldn't really want my kids around the clubhouse all the time. But what he did, he loved his son. He just wanted him to be with him. He'd put him in real school. He put him in public school during the off season. But during the season, he'd get a private tutor for him so he could travel with him. He didn't want to be away from his son. He didn't want his son to grow up and his daddy not to be there. That's pretty huge. And the club said, you can't bring him anymore. And so, you know what Adam LaRoche said? He said, well, I quit. He said no to the world. Oh, by the way, he gave up his salary this year. You know how much that was? $13 million. Sometimes saying no to the world's hard. Amen? $13 million. He said, my son is worth more than that. And me seeing him grow up is worth more than that. And me being with my family is worth more than that. But that's not the end of the story. I'm reading this week, and it just knocks me down. See, I'm kind of thinking, well, this wasn't really a smart move. I mean, I get the love in your family, but, you know, you got a job. You don't take your kids to the job and blah, 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 blah. But that wasn't really what changed. And he loves his boy. That wasn't really what changed his heart. You see what he did in November? Him and Blaine was a pitcher from the Milwaukee Brewers. Blaine's last name is Boyer. They get on a plane and go to Southeast Asia. And they're going to go in undercover. That's a Major League Baseball player. He's making $13 million a year. Why in the world does he have to worry about anything? If I was making $13 million a year, we'd be kicked back, wouldn't we, Birch? We'd be working out in the offseason, but man, we'd have it made. But he said, there's a need. You know what he did? He went to Southeast Asia undercover, and he goes in there and they rescue young girls that are underage, that have been kidnapped and stuck into these brothels and being used as slaves, sex slaves. And they bring these girls out and they bring them home undercover. That's peculiar. That's strange. That's saying no to the world. Him and Blaine's on the plane coming home. And he says, what in the world are we doing? He said, are we seriously going to go back and play a game for 8 months when there's more girls over there being misused and abused? He said, I'm not doing it. And Blaine said, that's his friend, said, I seen something in his eyes that God had got a hold of him. And God was going to change his life. And so now you look back, and guys, you will look back sometime 20 years from now, 30 years from now. You'll look back and you'll see God working here, and you'll see him working here, and you'll see him working here, and you'll see him working in different parts of your life. I can look back now and see him just molding me and making me to do what I do today. And I had no idea that I would be doing this someday. But now, let's put the pieces together. You see God working, and all of a sudden, it's not a big deal for Drake to come to the ball field, but now it is a big deal to go to the ball field. And guess who's orchestrating that move? That's God. I'm going to show you what's really important. And I want you to see if you'll see it. And Adam did. And Adam, through the Exodus project, that's the project that is going in there and getting these girls undercover and bringing them out of that. 12, 10, 11, 13, 14-year-old girls, guys. Can you imagine? And he said, it's not going to keep happening if I got anything to do with it. And through the Exodus project, he is going back undercover. It's going to be harder now. They could be looking for him now. They could take his life the next time he shows up in Southeast Asia. But he said no to the world. He said no to $13 million. He said no to people that were being taken and mistreated and abused. And he said, I will not let it happen if I can do anything at all possible about it. That's a life changer, amen? That's a life changer. And I'm telling you guys, when he said no to that contract and no, if I can't, he got blasted on social media. Y'all know how cruel social media can be. Y'all know what it's like on Facebook and Twitter. And if somebody does something they don't like, some people just jump on them with both feet and they just beat them to death. Oh, goodness, you need to leave your kids at home. They didn't understand the big picture. And guys, there's going to be a lot of times in your life you're not going to understand the big picture that God's doing. You're going to go, why in the world is it so hard right now? But just trust him. Only trust him. Only trust him. And he's making everything work together, and that big picture is going to come to life just a little bit down the road or maybe years down the road, and you'll realize, wow, that's what God had in mind. That's what God was trying to do for me. You don't be afraid to say no to the world. This last verse. This is what Jesus says, guys. Then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, say no to the world, okay? Take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. Let's keep reading. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose and forfeit their own soul? Whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes to his glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. And this is the one I want to end up with. And guys, this is what I kind of feel about you guys. I just love you to death, and I want you to look at this verse. Maybe when you get home, write this down in front of your new Bible, 1 Peter 2:9. But you are a chosen generation. Guys, there is no telling what God can do with this generation right here if you guys will be faithful. And it's going to be hard, all right? It's going to be hard. But you guys are smart and quick and knowledgeable, and you've got the love of heart of God down deep in you. A royal priesthood. That means we can go to God on our own. We can pray to him anytime we want. A holy nation. There's that word, a peculiar people. What does it mean? Treasured, costly. These people sitting right here that you call mom and dad and family, you're treasured. They paid a price for you, all right? They love you. You mean the world to them. They'd give anything for you. And God's the same way, billion times more. That ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into marvelous light. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to sit in darkness. He's called you out into the light, and you can bask in the great light of God. And I pray the very best for you guys. I pray God will just bless you so much you can't even stand it. And make sure you come and see Mama once in a while, all right? They cry all the time when y'all leave. But I love you guys. Don't we love them, church? Amen. What about you guys? We may be a long time removed from this. Next month will be 30 years, Grant, since I graduated college. That's old, isn't it? That's old, man. But you know what? I'm still learning every day. to say no to the world and yes to God, and no to Satan and yes to God, because he loves to work us over, doesn't he? Satan just loves to work us over. I pray that you will say yes to the Lord and no to this world a lot more. I pray that we will be peculiar people in such a way that others may know him, and that we will never chase so much stuff that we forget how real God is and how he wants to change our life. Man, what a mighty God we serve. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you today. I thank you for these guys. Lord, I have no idea what they're going to face, where they're going to go, what their journey will take them, where it will take them. But God, I know you do. You already know the whole breadth of their life. And Lord, I just pray that they would just follow you. And Lord, on those days that are hard, they will just ask you to help them. On those days that are good, they will praise you. And Lord, I pray that they will understand that they are treasured and they are costly. And Lord, you love them so very much, and we do too. Lord, help us all to realize that we need to be more peculiar for God. Help us to realize that serving you is not easy. It's denying self. It's taking up our cross and following you. And there's nothing easy to that, Lord. But Lord, someday we will be able to stand before you, robed in the righteousness of your Son. And we will be able to hear, "Well done. Enter into your eternity." Lord, I pray that all of us understand that it's not so much about the stuff, but it's about the things we're doing for the kingdom. Lord, we praise you today. We praise you for answered prayer this week. Lord, my prayers just seem inadequate today of how much I'm thankful for what you've done in our church family this week. And Lord, may we just take that and just share it with the world. Because, Lord, this week we saw your mighty hand. And I praise your name for that. Just go with us, Lord. Help us show your love. In your name we pray.
Hey, thanks for joining us today. If you have prayer requests, need to contact us, or need directions to the church, check us out online at fbckeiser.com. If you want to join us, we're located at 210 East Main Street, or give us a call at 870-526-2604, or send mail to P.O. Box 306, Keiser, Arkansas, 72351. We'd love to see you soon. Thanks again for joining us, and may God bless you.